Yeah, so that's our offer, is to connect international peers, young audiences who were born into the world at the same time, who can influence each other now more than ever before, and have them meet through watching a film, the film festival model. This is simply a mediated film festival model, but that their discussion of your film, or a test, a prototype of your film, gives you feedback for the acceptance of an international audience. And I think we've talked about it before. What I don't see in Berlin at the Generation section is a strong representation of American work. And so this is one of the offers I'm giving with Screen 360 TV.
Copy. Okay, so this image to join the scheduled screen, the screen will open on another page, and then I'm on Zoom. Okay.
Right, Zoom or whereby. I go back and forth, mainly with Zoom.
Okay, so and what happens? So I okay, so I'm on welcome to screen360.tv. I click on it and it takes me to another room on another page that's hosted on Zoom, and what happens?
And there's the two of us watching a film together. So it would be something like this. So let me get
Okay.
off of this section and bring you something like this. I'll just, this is a one of our, there we are. There we are. So you are watching that now, and you can see the YouTube screen.
Oh,
Okay.
yeah.
And put in the fridge.
Ah, I see. So
And do you
you didn't
play
think
it?
that
So
they were alive.
otherwise, I don't know.
And go ahead. What's that, Mark?
Oh, I was going to ask you if you'd go ahead and play so I could just see what it looks like.
Sure. So this is a Q&A with a teacher in Berlin. She's had her fifth grade class watch a film called Lobster Dinner, which is filmed in Rome, and it happens that she is an Italian teacher teaching kids who are Italian immigrants to Germany. And we
Not
have
good
the
anymore when you
director
cook
on.
them.
Ah, okay, Jacobo, you are chef. Bravo.
It's very true.
They're like,
I don't
I've
know how
never cooked lobster myself, but I have a question about the clap. When Leone at the meal, at the dinner, his mother's speaking and he claps like this, what does that mean?
film.
Cosa significa quando Leone fa così con le mani?
Ok, avete capito tutti la domanda? Cioè quando sta a tavola e stanno cucinando e stanno mangiando e Leone a un certo punto fa un gesto, no? Che richiama un po', diciamo, l'ordine d'attenzione perché stanno tutti quanti parlando e anche se lui non ha molta voglia di parlare con sua madre, perché non ha un buon rapporto con sua madre, in quel momento si sente di richiamare l'attenzione su di lui, perché magari in verità un po' vorrebbe essere, vorrebbe parlarle, e dunque per quello che fa quel gesto così un po' improvviso. Ve ne siete accorti, no? Di quel momento.
Io no.
Quando stanno mangiando.
Okay, so you get the sense that there's a Q&A happening here.
So can I ask a question or can I make a statement or both?
Both.
So this was something you recorded on Zoom and uploaded to
Yes, he gave me permission to bring up through YouTube. Yeah, and we have it.
YouTube? So one of the things I just wanted to recommend for these kinds of discussions where there are interpreters and multiple speakers kind of throughout the program is just to gallery view.
You're completely right. Yes, I recognize that. And much more interesting of course, when you can see all of the kids. And that was my miss. I think that day we were having trouble with the internet, and I was running around happy to have internet. Yeah, I think so. So that, but you're completely right. And even gallery is much more interesting, especially when you have 10 kids, which we did. And so I think it's an unusual opportunity for a filmmaker. And I think, how often do you show your work to young audiences, say seventh grade to high school?
I mean, you know, I haven't, you know, so it's interesting. So, I mean, with the G word, you know, we've been making shorts along the way, and I haven't done any screenings for young people, sort of that are organized, or, you know, that just hasn't happened yet. We've interviewed a lot of young people, and we spend time, you know, filming with a lot of young people, but we haven't done any sort of virtual or in-person events yet where I'm screening for young people. So that's kind of, you know, sort of TBD, you know, I think. But certainly the short films feature young people, right? So I definitely we connect those dots. You know, in terms of other films that I have made in the past, there's definitely been some pretty strong, you know, efforts to connect with younger audiences. Most notably, The Power of Two really worked with younger audiences. You know, did a bunch of screenings at high schools, and that was, you know, tied to getting kids excited to think about, thoughtfully about registering to be an organ donor. So that was a big, you know, engagement.
Did you work with Stanford on that?
I mean, Stanford was super engaged with The Power of Two. So both Stanford University, and there were sort of different things that they, you know, that they did with us along the way. I didn't do any sort of curriculum partnerships with Stanford, but, you know, we definitely had a really collaborative relationship with the university from and the hospital from a kind of marketing perspective. Both the UN, United Nations Association Film Festival, and then we came back. Yasmina brought us back for Camera as Witness for a special standalone event. And we did the organ donation signups at that event, I remember very well.
Wow. Smart.
But another film that has been really sort of kind of great for younger audiences is Havana Curveball, which I executive produced for Marsha and Ken.
Right. I wrote Marsha to interview her because I recall that we talked at length about it.
That was, you know, that movie, you know, was definitely sort of, you know, it had a strong youth arc.
Yeah.
And obviously, you know, about Micah, their offspring. Micah is the gender non-conforming person now, so they go by they.
Interesting.
Pronoun is they, but they were a young boy at the time in the stories of their bar mitzvah, right? So so that, you know, that movie was definitely one that, you know, like, we were part of, you know, schools at the festival, right, at SF Film, and Keith was very engaged with that movie, and Joanne Parson was very engaged with that movie. Both before when she was at SF Film and then when she moved over to, you know, California Film Institute. So, and you should talk to Marsha just in general, because we're, you know, I'm you know, working with them on their, you know, their new film Los Hermanos.
Okay.
And we have big ideas about sort of impact and engagement for next year that have to do with the film in front of, working with organizations that are sort of are helping, sort of young Black and Brown musicians be introduced to classical music.
Nice.
So in you know, in our nation's cities, there's some tentpole organizations around the country that are doing incredible work exposing young Black and Brown musicians to opportunities. And there's a bit of that.
Yeah.
It's a really nice one.
Nice work.
But, But so, I mean, you know, my feel, you know, I'm sure, I mean, Katie, look, you're living through this moment just like me and anyone who works in the film industry. So yeah. I have virtual film festivals and virtual presentations that are supported by interactive conversations like us having right now and watching something together is absolutely, you know, what we need to be looking at, right? And I think the question becomes sort of what's your, you know, what is your sort of user experience like, right? And the sort of, I'm so curious to sort of, you know, hear your take on this because, you know, I haven't encountered yet a tool that lets people watch together and have a very good experience watching virtually together, okay? Mostly it's this idea of we watch a film on one platform and then back on another platform and have a conversation about the film. And there hasn't really been a sort of single platform that brings both of those experiences together in a very high quality way. It's done. It's working. You know? It's clean and it's not seamless. It doesn't sort of forefront production values or the quality of the viewing experience. And which I think is okay if we just sort of, you know, that's what we want to be okay with, right?
Yeah.
But
yeah.
It's just something to be thinking about, right? Because I do think that especially with younger people, you know, you sort of, you know, their attention span is different or at least, you know, kind of specific to their experience, right? And they may or may not be as, you know, I don't know, predisposed to sort of spend time like this as we are, you know.
Yeah, I'm wondering how Quibi is doing with their very short films. I haven't watched them yet, and I should. There's also a program called Cast, which doesn't have a very nice interface. Maybe it's changed in the last couple of months. KAST. And it took over from a company called Rabbit. Maybe it was Jack Rabbit, which was exactly that, sharing films. And frankly, I find I've been using Whereby and Zoom. I find Zoom fine. Great.
Copy. Like, you know, 5 times a day, so I get that. And people are really comfortable with it now.
Yes, exactly. Whereby is a little different in that there's not so much the floating screens. It really does look like there is a television screen with smaller screens to the side that are watching the film together. And I like watching people watch the film. So that's not strange, really. And but of course, you can turn off your video.
So that's with Whereby?
WHERBYA.com.
I found it, but have you found it successful overall, though?
Yes. The thing it doesn't do, though, and that Zoom does that's so nice, is separate all of its recordings. Or it takes all of the recordings first, and then separates the sound recordings into individual streams, sound streams. The video is really high quality, and it's an MP4 directly. I have to go through a video translator in order to see Whereby's films. You know, it's just the what is that called? VLC. Use VLC, Zoom doesn't require that. So Zoom produces better artifacts than Whereby. That said, Whereby has been very kind to me and has sponsored us for 3 years.
Yeah, well, that's great.
That's nice. Wonderful. And as we've been developing, we continue to talk to them. So I'd like to keep that open and I bounce back and forth, but mainly stay with Zoom. They're in Oslo, Whereby.
Got it. That's great. No, that's great. Well, let me tell you a couple things from my side. If this is,
sure.
Did you focus more on your site first? I'm sorry, I didn't mean to kind of.
No, no. I want to understand what is of value to you in getting your films in front of international audiences, young audiences, and having your film presented and taught in a way. Mm-hmm. And so, for instance, if I were to present your film, you would come on afterwards with me and we'd have a Q&A together. And we could even increase the presentation and bring on specialists and certainly bring on like those that we met at your event, your fundraiser a few months ago.
Well, I mean, you know, for what it's worth, I'll in the Zoom chat, I'll just chat you this link. Mm-hmm. So this is a Vimeo gallery with 6 short movies that I've made while making the G Word. Uh-huh. Available and, you know, they are, you know, available on Vimeo and also on Facebook, right? When we release them, I release them on both. And then they get sort of put on this gallery. And I'm very open to presenting any combination of these on a platform like this. Mm-hmm. Be of interest to you. They're already out there, so, you know, it's not like you'd be premiering them, you know, but it would be providing an opportunity for people to watch them together and maybe have a conversation about them afterwards.
Sure, sure. Okay, that's good.
Grab that link and watch them at your convenience. That's of interest. One thing I will say, and this is more of a long-term conversation, but you know, I feel like it's good to share with you, is that, so you know, we're now editing the G Word. It's, you know, slowly but surely, mm-hmm, moving forward. And I have sort of, you know, a vision for outreach, engagement, and impact for this movie that is really coming together. So I have a very large list of advisors that are super awesome and amazing to work with, and a growing list of nonprofit and other kinds of partners, mm-hmm, that are largely US, but even a couple international ones. Along the way, while making this film, we have done more than 40 interviews, right? So really important and influential people, thought leaders, you know, people who have
Ben
incredible
Johnson.
Things.
Yeah, right. Tremendous. Yeah.
You know, I'm making what will likely be a 90-minute movie. So you can imagine that there's only, of all 40 interviews, there'll be like how many seconds of everybody in this, you know, 90-minute movie, right? So the initial vision is to create a platform, some sort of video on demand platform that will make all of these videos with all these interviews available, you know, in their entirety with all of these incredible experts, you know, on this platform, viewable and with downloadable transcripts and closed captions, right? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So interview content widely available for research, for people in the education space, et cetera, but then alongside of that, we're gonna create other kinds of content for this platform, which is, you know, video-based curriculums, advocacy guides, mm-hmm, you know.
Wow.
Laundry list of things that we've highlighted in our fundraising pitches that are sort of, you know, what we hope to do on this platform. And there's a number of ways to think about the platform, right? We could sort of build it ourselves and invite other people to co-brand it with, mm-hmm, us, mm-hmm, sponsors or as community collaborators, right? So that's, you know, or we can go to someone else's platform and like kind of be a vertical within their platform.
Sure,
right?
Sure. Mm-hmm.
We can do both, you know, because it's my content. I own it. I can, you know, we can do it non-exclusively in different spaces in order to, you know, help it find different kinds of audiences, sure, where those communities together online.
Yeah.
A big part of what we hope to do is create the possibility for professionals and educators to get continuing education units and contact hours through this platform. A very sweet spot part of this sort of offering here, because in graduate education, as you know, you know, to continue to get their professional development hours, they have to, you know, do that good work in order to stay certified. And anyway, so we have 3 national partners that are pretty substantial in the education business that are excited to build this out, want to help, you know. One of my advisors on the movie is a guy who's the CEO of OutSchool. I'm not sure if you've ever seen OutSchool, but it's a learning platform.
Yeah. I should just say that my team members are coming on now, and I know it's almost a half an hour, and I will bring in Dee Dee, and you can say hello, and I will show her the rest of...
when you have them, I'll just text them.
Yeah. Hi, Dee Dee. Whoop. There we go. Hi, Dee Dee. I want to introduce you to Mark Smolowitz.
Hi, nice to meet you.
Dee Dee Pierce.
Yes. How's it going? Good?
Wonderfully. Good. Mark is just telling me about his plans for a platform. And did you get a chance to look at the G word? We'll look at that afterwards. Dee Dee is an award-winning high school teacher and social studies, and the G word is about gifted students, gifted people.
I looked at it. It was interesting. There are a lot of interesting things on the information that you shared. So there was a lot of information. So I poked around and.
Done a lot of films so far.
Oh my god, and really impressive, very very impressive, you know, and some really good ones that I would like to see, really interesting ones. So yeah,
right on, thank you. You know, that's the idea, right? We make them, we want people to see them, you know. That's
right. Mark, I think we should continue this conversation.
I want to. But look, Katie, here's the thing. I adore you, okay? And I would and to help.
Mutual. It's mutual.
You know, if the asks get more specific in ways that I can support, I'm happy to know that. What is this early adopter network? What does that mean?
Those are people who want to basically be members of Screen 360 TV. Who want to be informed about what we're doing, who want their children who view films to get the 2-week follow-up where we ask them what they remember about the film. And that refreshes the memory and therefore fixes it in their memory. So this is the memory of an international film is fixed and therefore has greater capacity to attach to like memories and more like memories. And this is how we get instinct and comfort for things that are foreign. And this is especially why we want to show these films in places that are, you know, don't have a lot of diversity. Rural towns in America, for instance. No.
Yeah, I mean, my main thing is like, you know, I mostly just need to know kind of what I can do to be helpful to you. I mean, I think, you know, from the perspective of the G word, like when you have a hot minute, sit down and watch those 6 shorts, you know.
Yeah,
it's actually Dee Dee. Dee Dee, while making the G word, we've produced 6 short films over the arc of making this movie. And it's been a way for me to sort of figure out, you know, how I want to tell this story. Like, what is my main question that I'm asking in this film is who gets to be gifted in America and why in the 21st century? So looking at gifted education through the lens of race and gender and class and what I call zip code, right? And taking this very sort of like beautiful hyper-local lens so that the actual feature film will have 9 stories in different rural, suburban, and urban communities across, you know, many places around the country. And so these 6 shorts are examples of the stories, right? Or begin to give you a window into some of those stories. And it's been a way for me to figure out what stories I want to tell, what my visual style is, what my editing style is, how to work with experts, how to work with archival. And you'll see, in fact, if you watch them in the order that they're on that page, you'll start to see a development in how I'm telling these stories, I think.
Right.
That feels clear and sort of cohesive. And, you know, it's an hour of programming. So there could be a way to sort of show them as one experience.
Sure.
And or curate, you know, 2 out of 6 or 3 out of 6 or whatever you think, and try and experiment on your platform. I mean, if that was helpful to you. Right.
Well, so that is part of the ask. You know, what value is it to you to show to an international audience that we would provide?
It's would very there be a- nice. I just did a webinar with a group in Holland, you know, that hungry for these stories. As the movie about gifted, right? So we're the most ambitious movie about gifted education ever made. I say this a lot in my talks, like I get emails from Singapore to Switzerland, you know, I mean, you name it. I'm hearing from everywhere.
Right.
And there are families that are struggling with their, you know, with their gifted neurodiverse children. Mm-hmm. I'm not getting in their own country, in their own community, and everyone wants a movie. You know, they all want their movie. They want the movie to come to them. You know, I obviously can't make a movie for everyone, right? But I can have a community engagement strategy that honors these people and their voices. And mm-hmm. include. We have some fun social media experiments that we've already have in play that are doing good work, but like that. But yeah, I mean, the work is out there on Vimeo and Facebook, so people can connect with it, right?
Sure.
So anything that sort of helps serve up this content in a package way that's international is, you know, definitely of interest. I think the big question for me around the international potential for this movie is, will it work outside of the United States?
Right.
Decidedly American story, right? I'm focusing on the American education system. I'm focusing on a very American narrative, but I'm taking a very human approach to these stories. I'm forefronting emotion over information, and really looking at family systems and
nice.
You know, other kinds of, so it, you know,
I think there'll great be a value internationally, frankly.
Yeah. Oh, I hope so. I mean,
it
I think
it should be translated.
Movie in Switzerland and Singapore, but I'd like to try to make one that people will want to see in those places, you know?
I have a couple of questions though. One is, in your film, do you define giftedness, you know, and do you, and who says to determine define gift, you know, giftedness? Who?
Big, so that's a big part of the film, right? Is so like what is gifted, right? Like what defines it? And so gifted in, you know, in the last century, in the 20th century, was very much defined by a person's IQ, right? Or test performance, right? In this century, we're moving far away from that, right? And we're trying to look at the whole person, right? And so my movie believes that there is such a thing as innate intelligence. And I think I do believe that there are, frankly, some very smart people out there. Okay, like that is just a true fact. And we know that. But they don't all look like Elon Musk and Mark Zuckerberg and Bill Gates, right?
Right. So right.
That's trying to say, like, what does it look like when you have giftedness, you know, at the border with Mexico, giftedness on a Native American reservation? Like that's where my stories reside. Yeah. And so I'm highlighting ideas of neurodiversity and what our audiences will learn are the concepts of emotional intelligence and multiple intelligence, right? And the sort of the kind of whole person, the whole neurodiverse person.
Right. Well, that's very interesting, you know, because when I in the classroom, like I taught multiple intelligences, right? So all my teaching in one classroom was they were activities that, you know, that appealed to different intelligences, and then it was interesting to watch it happen. You know, you saw the kids, they were artistic, you saw the kids, they were creative or musical, and you saw the kids that were really very, very, you know, literate, you know, and thoughtful, etc. But it's true. It's very, very true. But it's like not everyone defines it as such. You know, in a regular classroom where there's curriculum, there's standards, and there's tests, etc. Kids get lost, right? Kids get lost, and they're not tapped into. They're not tapped into. So, do you address Black America?
Oh God, yeah.
Yeah.
So. Yeah, that's a huge vertical. No, I mean, so the African American intelligence narrative is a big, big beat in this movie. And there's already
with Van Johnson.
There's already a short of one of those 6 that you can watch where I introduce you to how we're going to tackle that part of the story.
That's great.
Nice.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
That's good. That's good. It's what we are focusing on right now is how to mitigate racism and xenophobia through engaging with international films and focused films that are taking it apart and helping us reflect and look at it. And so that was our pivot that we decided on last week in our sort of what would you call it? We were hacking Screen 360 TV to help it focus. And that's the direction we're going. And it would be wonderful to look at your films, Mark, and use them.
And if there's something you want to try to devise, I can also help. We can do our own social marketing and bring an audience to it, right? And that would give your platform more exposure. There is something I wanted to just kind of call your attention to, though, Katie, and that that a lot of these virtual platforms right now, like there's Inventive, Cinescend, and a couple of others. I can send you an email about them, but I've noticed that in the time of COVID, they're being very sort of collaborative and offering special programs for nonprofits and educational institutions to kind of do things with their platform. And so that could be something for you to look at just going forward, as you try to build your platform experience.
Right.
So let me see if I can tell you. There was one in particular.
Frameline went out on Cinescend, right? I talked to...
Frameline went out on Cinescend, which I thought looked great.
Did it? Okay.
But there was a... I was actually talking with them about platforms, and what's really interesting, so there's something called Paragon Live. I'm going to just text you this to your iMessage.
Thank you.
That I encounter... I encountered because I'm doing a lot of this of my own sort of work, where they do these kind of unbranded platforms, right? So they'll build it, and you can sort of, it can look however you need it to look. It's for screen to have your own sponsors or whatever,
It's really nice. Thank you. Yeah, I've been plugging away with this prototype for a little while now, and it's time to build something.
Just sharing resources. I've been trying to figure these things out myself, so I get it.
Well, we're looking at that, of course, and an app that will live on tablets. And various education thought leadership. Thank you. That's great.
There's so much happening right now. It's amazing, totally amazing, which is out there. It's crazy.
It's exactly. And I think in that context, so what's fascinating is that my movie, The G Word, before COVID was sort of existing in a certain kind of trajectory of change to education that you're all aware of, right? Families at every income level are not having their needs met, in all kinds of ways. And so they're opting out of school, right?
Yeah. Well,
guess what? A pandemic happens and all families have to opt out of traditional school.
Right.
And, of course, that comes a huge challenge for parents and work and school and home and all those things they're managing. But how much I can only imagine the conversations that are going on in households everywhere right now. About school and how to make sense of this new way that they have to think about school.
Mark, Dee Dee and I both attended a seminar this morning, or a Zoom. Zoom and Polycom are collaborating on grants for schools. So that might be, and you probably do know about homeschooling networks, right? Do you engage with homeschooling? You're all about that.
Yeah, one of my major partners is the Gifted Homeschoolers Network, right?
Okay.
And so this is a huge community that is decidedly secular, okay? Because there's a whole homeschooling movement that is religious and evangelical, right?
Right.
So that's what it is. But this group is secular and has and defines it as such, and so is thankfully much more inclusive, much more welcoming, and what's interesting is that this platform that I told you about called OutSchool,
yeah,
was one of my advisors. They scaled because the homeschool community discovered them and got really excited, and then. So it's just, So right now, like all the parents that were ahead of the curve with homeschooling are really ahead of the curve, right?
Right.
Mm-hmm. I wonder if there's, I don't know. I wonder if there's homeschool network in inner cities communities. I wonder if someone's leading that yet, because I think that divide is just going to be bigger. And I'm just wondering, there's a call for that right now to bring everybody up or keep them up as best possible. But I don't know. I haven't heard of that yet.
Well, I will. So let me just show you. So it's it's ghflearners.org. GHF Learners. So it stands for Gifted Homeschool. Forum, yeah. Forum. So it's gflearners.org.
Okay, got it.
And they're one of my three major national partners on this movie. They're amazing. They're just amazing.
Great, great. That's a focus. Really, is homeschooling for us, and we've just begun interviewing people who have homeschooled their kids. And a little bit
you
less.
You should into me on that piece because this is a community with tens of thousands of families that we access.
Wow.
Literally. Wow.
I mean it. And I'm actually meeting with them on Thursday. And I'm happy to mention, you and this platform to them. They're some amazing people.
Yeah.
Right.
It's interesting. It's really interesting because I did my research also and it's amazing how homeschoolers are really performing really, really well on ACTs, SATs, AP classes. So there's a lot of legitimateness behind homeschooling. Before it used to be something like crazy, but now definitely it's very much a developed. So.
I just wish it could be shared more.
And how people live, right? And that is what it reflects that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
It has accelerated that fact.
Yep. Captain Fantastic. Really, everybody's moving off of the grid in a way. Yeah. Oh, that's good. Well, yeah, I really appreciate that, Mark, if you would mention. If you want a little blurb, happy to send that over. Is there something in particular that you want or just have them take a look at screen360.tv?
Anything, I'm happy to have it. You can't overwhelm me with information. So, send me
that's amazing. Good for you. That's great.
Put my thinking cap on and talk to Danielle and Tim who work with me on this movie and let them know that you have the Vimeo gallery and you're going to watch the shorts. Mm-hmm. You may remember meeting Tim. Tim was at the event last year that he came to. But we can sort of, circle back in a couple weeks, and after you get a chance to watch the films and maybe we can figure out an event we can do before the end of the summer.
That's a nice idea. Yeah. And definitely we need to start developing these events to present Screen 360 TV and, still fundraising.
Yeah. You tell me what what you would like to do. If there's some kind of prototype or something, if there's something you need to figure out, Like, if there's a learning you want to do, I'm happy to try. So,
yeah, thank you. Okay, I'll introduce you to Jack before you jump off.
Sure, and happy to say.
Here he comes, Jack.
There he is.
It's coming on almost. Went on mute there, Jack.
Hello,
Jack Raz. Meet Mark Smolowitz.
Hi, Mark.
Director, producer of G Word and many, many more.
Nice to meet you. So, Jack, where do you live?
I live in Los Gatos, Bay Area. Yeah.
And Dee Dee, where are you?
I'm in Ohio, Chagrin Falls.
Oh my goodness.
So Dee Dee, yeah. Dee Dee had taught at Los Altos schools, and she was 2006 Teacher of the Year, and moved to Chagrin Falls and started a high school film festival there. And we met, I was giving a talk to Stanford alumni, and Dee Dee was there. And Jack and I met for this class, the Hacking for Recovery class, and I pitched what Screen 360 TV was about, and here comes this USC business and cinema student over, and he says, I love your idea, so here's our team.
Right.
Yeah, I'm so fortunate that after working a week together, we're going to continue.
Well, good for you. I mean, this is, you know, you guys, so Katie has been walking the walk in the independent film business for many, many, many years. Or you're, you know, signing on with somebody who everyone loves and she's got great credibility. So now I'll just say it in front of her. She's lovely and talented and amazing.
Thank you, Mark.
You're welcome. You know, and Jack, I can't stay on much longer because I have a 5 o'clock for something else, but long story short, I'm making this movie about gifted and talented education in America. It's the most ambitious movie on that topic ever made. And if you guys want to do stuff together, we can figure it out. So,
good. We'll come up with some more specifics for you, Mark.
Love yeah. it.
So, Jack, entrepreneur in the film and entertainment world. So, I'm sure we could probably put our heads together and try to come up with something fun.
I love that. Yeah, I'd love to.
Sweet. All right.
Great, Mark.
Please share that link with Dee Dee and with Jack. It's in the chat, so everyone
will do.
Can... Yes, sure.
And then we can circle back soon. Okay.
Okay, sounds Mark. Good. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Ciao, ciao. Bye, bye.
Bye.